Good evening and welcome to tonight's Zoom conference on Las Villas of Plattekill and Ulster County. And thank you all for coming. We started the month with a presentation about the Peg Leg Bates Resort. And at the beginning of that, I had mentioned that in the beginning of the 19th century, the Hudson Valley was kind of the birthplace of romanticism in America. The river itself was seen as America's answer to the Rhine, and the sites and along the river were parts of the American Grand Tour. And the hills of the valley and the mountains of the Catskills became a kind of a playground for European tourists and for the elite of New York, the grand mountain houses. And then also the smaller towns popped up that were for the sort of the middle class of the I don't know what term to use. It was the non-immigrant. It was the native born class of people. And this was not an area that was particularly open or friendly to immigrants of any kind. And then at about the turn of the 20th century, the late 19th, early 20th century, people from the city, immigrant groups from the city, started to look for ways to escape the crowding, escape the dirt and grime, and bought farms in this region, and eventually turned those farms into guest houses, and then the guest houses into resorts. And so I thought that this would be a wonderful time to bring Ish's work to the community. I had seen it in 2016 when the book first came out, and I was first appointed Ulster County historian. My first trip was to the Plattekill Historical Society. I didn't know what was there, but I just thought I would go down and see what the far reaches of the community look like. And Ish gave this talk there. It was kind of, it was like being in a living room in a way, in the sense that practically everyone in the audience had lived through this period of time and couldn't wait to share stories of it. And I just left with the biggest smile on my face. And I've been looking for an opportunity to bring him to the Kingston area for a long time. And I'm glad that this opportunity here on Zoom, which can cast a wider net. I know there's a friend of mine on here from Florida right now. And so it's a great opportunity, and I'm happy that you're here and this is coming together. But first, I wanted to take a couple of minutes because we lost two historians of note. The first was Shirley Anson last December, and I also met her for the first time in 2016 when I went to the Plattekill Historical Society. And she said to me, "Oh, an Ulster County historian. I haven't seen one of you in years." And I just fell in love with her immediately. She was a great person, did great things for her region, did great things for history and the whole county. And so we're going to hear from Libby Werle in a moment talking about her. But we also lost just earlier in June Vernon Benjamin, who I had only met once. So I don't know that much about him as a person, but I did serve on a panel with him once, and that was the one time. And he recently had published a 2-volume work on the history of the Hudson Valley, which is quite an accomplishment. And so I've also asked, Gail Manny is going to speak about him. I hope she is on. So first I'm going to turn to Libby, who I see up in the upper right-hand corner of my screen. And I'm going to ask her to speak for a few minutes about Shirley Anson.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk about Shirley. She was a dear friend of mine and many to many people. I first met her about 30 years ago, and I got to know her through local history. At the time, I was working as a reporter for the Southern Ulster Times. My editor asked me to write about local history, focusing specifically on the town of Plattekill. And I didn't know much about the history of my town at that time. But over and over, when I approached different people about story ideas, I was always told, you need to talk to Shirley Anson. She'll know. And so I attended a meeting of the Plattekill Historical Society, and I quickly found out that Shirley knew more about local history and about history in general than anyone I'd ever met. And she couldn't have been more welcoming. By the time I left that first meeting, she'd given me the Historical Society schedule for the rest of the year. She'd given me ideas for several articles, and she'd already scheduled a date for us to sit and have coffee together and talk about history. Like Jeff said, people just fell in love with her instantly. She was so passionate about the history of this area and Plattekill in particular. And it wasn't difficult to get caught up in her excitement, her nonstop energy. She'd been the Plattekill town historian for many years, and she founded the Plattekill Historical Society. And she just really lived for sharing her love of history with other people. After covering just a few meetings for the paper, she presented me with an award for being the Historical Society's favorite reporter. And I was the only reporter, but before I knew what had happened, I was somehow the secretary for the Historical Society. And she just knew how to draw people in and make things happen. And it wasn't too long before she suggested that I gathered some of my stories and the stories that she had been helping me collect into a book. And again, in what seemed like an instant, she'd set up a little office for me in her house and next to all of her files. And then all of a sudden I was writing a book, you know, thanks to Shirley. She was just so generous with her stories and her collection of postcards, pictures, and notes. And what she did for me, she did for so many local authors and historians, including Ish. We all knew we were able to rely on her for her research. And she was always so excited when new books on local history would come out. And I remember when Ish's book was scheduled to be published, I think I received an email or a phone call from her every day, reminding me we had to order copies. Did we order copies? We have to order more copies. We had to book Ish as a speaker. She was just so excited and so happy to promote others. And she was a noted author herself. Her book, Friends and Neighbors, Pictorial History of the Town of Plattekill, Southwest Lloyd, has been an instrumental guide to the area. And her Quaker Genealogy of Ulster County is the definitive resource documenting the Quaker influence here in the area. But one of her greatest passions was preserving and speaking about the cemeteries in Plattekill. And a favorite project of hers was our book, Hallowed Grounds, which was about Plattekill cemeteries. And she worked endlessly to document the stories of those in the old family and community cemeteries so that the stories wouldn't get lost, especially veterans. And it would always make me laugh when she would tell me that for her birthday or for Mother's Day, all she had asked her family for was to bring her to some of the town's abandoned cemeteries to help clear brush or to clean the headstones. That's what she wanted as a present. And right up into her death in December, she was working on a book about Plattekill Civil War veterans. She spent years researching the book, but she never felt really ready to publish it because she didn't want to overlook anything or leave anyone out. And I remember her telling me that all of their stories needed to be told and all of their names needed to be spoken so that their contributions to the town would always and to their country would always be remembered. And so I think for many of us, this sums up why we do what we do as historians. We continue to celebrate and to write about and to speak to others about those people who've made a difference in our communities, people like Shirley Anson, so that they will never be forgotten. So thank you for giving me a few minutes just to talk about my friends, and all of our friends, Shirley.
Thanks, Libby. That was great. Yeah, she had a way of talking to me where she, it was just kind of like dropping little hints about what she thought I should do. And but she had a way of doing it where it didn't put me off. It sort of planted an idea. And she was truly great. So the person I had asked to speak about Vern, I got a message in the chat from Karen that she isn't online yet. So the best I can do, unless someone else out there knows something about him, is to read from the obituary from the Daily Freeman at the time. He passed away at age 76. He was a lifetime area resident and a graduate of Saugerties High School, and went on to receive a bachelor's degree from Siena College in Loudonville and a master's degree from CW Post in Brookville. He had a career in public service, which included serving as a Saugerties town supervisor from 1990 to 91 and as a county legislator. For many years, he served as a top aide to Congressman Maurice Hinchey in Albany, and until Maurice left for Congress in 1993. Among his work was a focus on the Hudson River Valley environment. In that regard, he played pivotal roles in the passage of the Hudson River Estuary Management Act of 1987 and the creation of the Hudson River Greenway. The Estuary Management Act involved 9 state agencies, as well as the support of 7 federal agency and an advisory committee of nonprofit community and environmental organizations with stakes in the estuary's health. As a writer of several history books about the Hudson Valley, he also wrote a weekly column in the Saugerties Post Star and the Woodstock Times, and was a founding member and contributing writer to the Tudlam Tales. He served as an adjunct professor at Marist College, and he was employed by the town of Saugerties as a special grant writer from 2013 until his death. So he was a very active in many spheres, and especially in the environmental sphere, we all owe him a debt. If there's anyone else on the Zoom tonight who worked with him or knows him at all and would like to contribute a few words, feel free. Okay, so then we'll move on to tonight's presentation by Ismael Martinez, who is your parents own the Sunny Acres Resort, right?
That's right.
So you grew up in this environment. This was what you did, right? Are you involved in the picture on the cover at all, or any of those you?
I'm not, no.
Okay.
That's a band that played at my parents' villa, though.
Okay. So aside from being the author of Las Filas of Plattekill in Ulster County, which is available from Arcadia Publishing, you're the treasurer and trustee for the Plattekill Historical Preservation Society, as well as being on the board of the Rossville Church and Cemetery Association in the town of Newburgh. And you also, which is nice, aside from historical pursuits, you like to play golf and indulging your three grandchildren, Mila, Liam, and Lucy.
Right.
Did I say the first
thing? The light of my life, yep.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm a new grandparent, and I can feel your love on this thing. So I'm going to turn the program over to you, and I'm going to mute myself, and we'll see you.
Okay. All right. Well, first, let me thank Jeff and Karen and Susan for having me do this this presentation. I love to do these talks because I feel like it keeps the history of the Villas alive. And so that's my main pursuit for doing it, to keep them alive, to memorialize my parents and all the villa owners that worked so hard during the time that the villas were here. So let me, I'm gonna go over to the PowerPoint. Oh, and let me add that when I did write this book, which was, as Jeff mentioned, in 2016, of course, I had some photos and many stories and the history of my own before I actually dove into researching it further. And as I did that, I knew I needed more photos because these books published by Arcadia Publishing are pretty much standardized. They're 128 pages. So you have to be careful with your wording. You have to really condense it. And there are about 220 photos. But I did know that I needed more information and especially more photos. And the first place I thought of to go for photos was the Plattekill Historical Society. I didn't know anyone at the society at the time. I just reached out to both Shirley and Libby Werlu, because researching online, I saw that Libby Werlu was the town historian and Shirley was a president of the Historical Society. So it was natural for me to reach out to them, not knowing what kind of reception I would get. I got the warmest reception I could ask for, and lots and lots of help. Many photos. They spent hours with me, and literally I could not have done it without their help. And especially Shirley, as we mentioned, she had a way of just bringing you in and making you feel welcome. And so that really made the process so easy.
Ish, before we go further, I would just like to add, because I forgot to say it before, that if people have questions while you're talking, they should just put them in the chat, and Susan Sprackman is monitoring that. And at the end, I'm going to turn the question and answer period over to her. So just use the chat for questions for now.
Okay, perfect. Okay,
great, thanks a lot.
Okay. All right, so. Okay, so here we are. Let me ask you to pretend for just a moment that you are cruising in your 1964 canary yellow Chevy Impala going north on Route 32, heading into Plattekill. The first thing you might notice is that there's the smell of roasted pork wafting through the air. Of course, many of the villas did this outside, almost like pigs on a spit, and they literally, the smell would just envelop you as you went by. Then you might hear the sound of a Latin beat, and it might sound something like this.
noche. Yo vengo de Oriente con ritmo caliente que te hace gozar, que te hace gozar. Oye, yo traigo alegría mía de esta tierra mía, mía, que te hace gozar, que te hace gozar. Yo traigo miel de maracas, sabor a caña, y bailo bien mi pachanga con mucha maña. Oye, 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 yo soy santiaguero de los pachangueros de Ponce que saben bailar, que saben bailar.
So that would be that. That piece was done by the great Joe Puba, and he had a band which was called a sextet. And the sextet generally had only percussion instruments, so you didn't hear any horns or anything like that. It was piano, timbales, which are drums, congas, aguido, which is a Puerto Rican instrument, and the vibraphones that you might hear. Joe Puba was very, very popular during the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And his music played in every jukebox practically. And he even made a couple of appearances at Las Villas, at Villa Toto for one. They played a couple of numbers as an intro as you signed on. The first one was Envidia, by a musician called Vicentico Valdez. And Vicentico Valdez was a great crooner. He did a lot of ballads. They did have the numbers too, but he was really noted for doing boleros, or the slower numbers. The other one was by the Orquesta Broadway, and it was Puerto Rico, Me Encanta. And those were both very big bands, again, during the era of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Okay, so I'll talk about my book a little bit. Of course, the book is Las Villas of Plattekill in Ulster County. It came out on July 25th of 2016, as was mentioned previously. It was published by Arcadia Publishing in their local history series. And I think they call Images of America. And you can identify it because it's got that typical local history type look with the sepia colored page. You've seen them for just about every town in America, I would almost imagine. Libby Werlew actually did one for the town of Plattekill. Okay, so a little bit about me. My name is Ismael Ish Martinez Jr. I'm a junior. My father was Ismael. They called my father Shorty, pretty much because he was about my height. And they differentiated me by calling me Ish. Neither one of us went by Ismael. I have a comp sci degree from Quinnipiac University. I've retired from, after 30 years, from as a systems engineer from IBM and Verizon. I was born in the Bronx. I am of Puerto Rican descent. Both of my grandparents on both sides were born in Puerto Rico. And we moved to Plattekill when I was 5 years old. Although my parents had already purchased the property in 1948. So before 1954, they were coming up on weekends, trying to run the business on weekends and during the season. I'll get into this a little more, but most of the villas or villas were run seasonally. So mostly May through September. And most of the time when the kids were out from school and people were having summer vacations. My wife and I, Maryann and I, currently live in Fishkill, New York, with our 17-year-old cat named Tino. And sometimes we think that Tino is in such good health, he might outlive us. We fear that. And I fear that mostly because I worry about who's gonna take care of Tino. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the Catskill region. And Jeff covered this somewhat rather accurately. The Hudson Valley and the Catskills have been a vacation mecca for since the 1800s, literally. I mean, thousands and thousands of people have come through and visited the Catskill region. As we all know, and I'm sure most of you are locals, and you know how beautiful the Catskills are, and that's the type of environment that that people sought out, and especially people from New York City. And of course, they were drawn to the Catskills because of its pristine, atmosphere, its beauty, and its breathtaking scenery. And whether we're talking about the romanticized paintings captured here by Hudson River School artists, men like Thomas Cole, Frederick Church, Albert Albright, and Jasper Crosby, whether we're talking about that romanticized version, which is very beautiful, or just the scenes captured by photographers, I think we all can admit that the Catskill region is just a beautiful area and perfect for vacations, outings, and things like that. And so through the years, the region has just captured the imagination of millions of people, literally from all over the world. I was born in New York City, but I grew up in the Hudson Valley. And for many years, I kind of took it for granted that we lived in such a beautiful area. But over the years, I've come to appreciate it, especially after going to other parts of the country and even to Europe. I mean, this is a gem, like many others that we talk about in Europe. Okay, so the Catskill region was a region of hotels. Many of them were grand hotels, as in the case here, which is the Catskill Mountain House. And the Catskill Mountain House was one of the larger hotels in the region. It was situated near Haines Falls and North Lake in that region. Similar to the Catskill Mountain House, which offered many amenities, was also the Catskill Hotel. And the Catskill Hotel has kind of a story in that the owner of the Catskill Hotel had been going to the Catskill Mountain House, and he got into a conflict with the owners of the Catskill Mountain House because he felt that his daughter was being snubbed or she wasn't getting enough attention. So being a millionaire, he went and decided to build his own hotel, and he built this, the Catskill Hotel. And at the time that it was built, it was the largest hotel, not only in the Catskills, but in the country. And aside from the great mountain hotels, of course, there were hundreds and hundreds of smaller guest houses, lodges, boarding houses, and so forth throughout the Catskill region. Now, if we look at the Mohonk Mountain House, it is one of the few remaining grand hotels, although it's not literally in the Catskills, it's in the Shamgar Range. It is in the foothills of the Catskills, and it just harkens back to those grand hotels of the past. And I'm sure many of you have seen it or been there. And if you haven't, you should take a special trip to go see it. It's just a marvelous place. It's almost fairy tale like. So how did people know about these mountain houses, these grand hotels, and these guest houses, lodges, and so forth? One way they knew about it was through newspaper ads. But besides newspaper ads, there were also these directories. And the directories were published by different companies. In the case here, you had the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, which already had a newspaper that it published in Brooklyn. And aside from the newspaper, they also published this directory. There was also the Handy Book, and that was a private publishing company that pretty much concentrated on this directory of lodges, hotels, and other places to stay. Now, if we look inside, if you were to look inside of the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, for example, it would look something like this. The book was kind of broken up into regions. You can see here the Hudson River West would be one region. The Hudson River East would be another region. The Capital District, the Adirondack Range, Western New York. So it covered the entire state in different regions. And in fact, it even expanded out to other states. You might see lodges and hotels in New Hampshire and Vermont. You can see here that it would arrange it by towns. You see Montgomery, Mountainville, Newburgh, Wallkill. And within those towns, it would list all the guest houses, boarding houses, lodges, and hotels. It would tell you how many they accommodate. It would tell you how close it was to the nearest water, river, or lake. It would tell you if it was near golf courses. So it gave you a lot of information. I think people really depended on this kind of information. I don't know if it cost the individual hotels and guest houses. I don't know if it cost them anything to list in these directories. I'm guessing that it probably didn't. I think it was the publishers depended on the sale of the directory and the advertisements that were inside. Okay, so it's in this backdrop of previously grand hotels, guest houses, and lodges that we find the Spanish and Hispanic villas make their entrance. And in my research, the earliest one I can find is La Perla de Cuba. And La Perla de Cuba was established, according to the owner, who was Manuel Barros. It was established in 1912. It was located not in Ulster County, but in Delaware County, which is further north, in Stamford, New York. Now, there are many hotels that were in existence in Stamford, New York at the time. In fact, I think the local politicians of Stamford like to call themselves the Queen of the Catskills because there were so many hotels there. Prior to being La Perla de Cuba, it had another name, a non-Hispanic name, I think it was the Canton Inn, something like that. I also show here the Hotel Havana, which was another Cuban hotel and also located in Stamford. Prior to being Hotel Havana, it was the Simpson Terrace. And Hotel Havana was owned and operated by two people, Sanchez and Morante. And apparently they were businessmen. I believe that Sanchez had businesses, or Barros, who owned La Perla de Cuba, owned hotels in Cuba, and then seasonally would come up from Cuba and probably through New York City, come up to Stamford and run this hotel seasonally. So another way for them to get the word out about the various hotels, and it was the same with the Spanish and Hispanic hotels as it was with all the others. They would advertise in the newspaper, and the top article here, you can see the Villa Garcia, Hotel Perla de Cuba, and Hotel Havana. And those are being advertised in a Spanish newspaper, in this case, La Prensa. So there were communities in New York City that had a very big Spanish or Hispanic population. And so they would produce these Spanish speaking newspapers, and it was a good place for them to advertise. You can see down below that the Brooklyn Daily Eagle actually had advertisements for the non-Hispanic resorts and hotels. You can see Catskill Mountains, the St. Elmo, Otto House, and so forth. And they also advertised the Hispanic hotels as well. On the right is an ad for the Roxmoor. And that, again, was a non-Hispanic hotel or resort that was purchased by a Spaniard. And so the clientele changed over from non-Hispanic to Spanish and Spanish immigrants. Okay, so let's talk about what were Las Villas. So the Las Villas was a generic name that people used when they were going to make a visit to Plattekill or to Ulster County to visit any one of the different resorts or villas that existed there. So they might tell you they were going to Villa Garcia or Villa Nueva, or they might say, I'm going to La Villa. And that just generically meant I'm going up to that area where all the Spanish resorts are, and I'm gonna just have a good time, maybe at one, maybe at more. Most were located in the town of Plattekill. There was a large concentration in Plattekill. There were another dozen or so that were located closer to the Catskill Mountains in the area of Route 28, west of Kingston. And then there was a smattering. There was one in Ellenville called the Overlook. There was another one in Rifton called the Rifton Hotel. And there were a few others that were actually in the town of Newburgh. But generally speaking, they were in an area that you could get to in a day's drive or less by car from New York City. So at first, these resorts were just places to get out of the city. The city tended to be hot in the summer. They were gritty, they were noisy. And people, they enjoyed and sought after the same kinds of things that vacationers to the Catskills have done for years and years. They were looking to relax, to enjoy the country setting, to enjoy the mountains. And it was the same with Spanish immigrants and later with Puerto Ricans. They varied in size. Some were very small. They did not have accommodations. They ran maybe a bar and a dance hall. They may not even have live music. They may just have a jukebox. They might sell food. It might be, snacks. It might be something more. So they went anywhere from one building facilities to much larger facilities that had 50 or 60 units to rent, and that had maybe many more amenities, including live music, swimming pools, tennis courts, and so forth. Okay, so how did they come about? Well, very simply, the first ones, and I'll say aside from the three or four that existed in Stamford, which were primarily owned by Cubans, the vast majority of other ones in Ulster County were started mostly by Spanish immigrants at first. And again, this was early in the 20th century, as Jeff mentioned. It was around the 1920s in Plattekill, where Spanish immigrants were coming out of the city. They probably were tired of the factory work they may have gotten once they had immigrated from Spain. They probably wanted to get back to their roots of having an estate, a villa, a hacienda, and they probably sought these farms that were up for sale. Many were boarding houses, also up for sale, and they picked them up. They either converted them and started them as farms and worked them as apple orchards or dairy farms or chicken farms. Most of them were small and manageable. And more than anything, they wanted a place where their friends and people that shared their culture could gather and just enjoy being with each other, talking about the old country and how things were and how they were today. You know, all the simple things in life, you know, they might just have vast lawns where they sat out and talked. They might just listen to music on the radio, or someone may have brought their guitar and they listened to music that way. So they were pretty basic in the beginning, but very relaxing, and I'm sure rewarding to most of the people that came up. By the 1940s, Puerto Ricans and other Latinos had started to discover Las Villas. And although my grandparents had been here since the 1920s, many other Puerto Ricans did not migrate to the mainland until the 50s and later. So that big influx made them want to do the same thing that the Spanish immigrants had done, and that is to buy farms and maybe run them as farms or convert them into villas and resorts. Okay, so the earliest one that I can find, and there were several that popped up during the 1920s, but I believe the first one was the Villa Rodriguez. And the Villa Rodriguez was located in the town of Plattekill on Unionville Road. Now, the majority of the villas that happened to be in Plattekill were on about three main roads. One was on Route 32, the other one was Plattekill-Ardonia Road, and the third one was Unionville Road. And then there were smattering of others on other roads. But this was the Villa Rodriguez. It was run by a Spanish immigrant, again, named Alejandro Rodriguez. He came out of Cuba, actually. He had been working in Cuba as a cigar roller. Tampa, Florida at the time had a very large Cuban population. So Alejandro had gone from Cuba and then to Tampa, where they had set up this huge tobacco rolling industry in an area called Ybor City. And they probably produce more Cuban cigars than anywhere in the world. And cigars in the early part of the 20th century was a huge industry. So Alejandro bought this farm and soon converted it into a villa called Villa Rodriguez. So let me talk a little bit about the villas that were not in Plattekill. But as I mentioned, there were a dozen or so that existed west of Kingston for the most part, and pretty much in the Catskill Mountains themselves along Route 28. Up in the left there, you see some numbers that correspond to the numbers on the right. So you had the Hollywood Hotel, which was in High Mount or Pine Hill. You had La Cabana, which was also in Pine Hill. You had the Lakeside Lodge. And these were, by the way, these were all owned by Spanish immigrants, except for the Hollywood Hotel, I think, was owned by Puerto Ricans. But the La Cabana and Lakeside Lodge, both in Pine Hill, were owned by Spanish immigrants, as was the Glenbrook Hotel and La Granja, which was in Alaban. The Glenbrook was in Shandaken. And the Roxmore Inn, which was in Woodlands, just outside of Phoenicia. So the Glenbrook, again, you'll see names that are not Hispanic names. Sometimes like La Cabaña, Spanish, Lakeside Lodge, not Spanish, because some of the owners decided to keep the name that the previous owners had put for the hotel. Why they did that, maybe because the name just carried weight as a rule, or maybe for financial or fiscal reasons, no one really knows. The Roxmore Inn was another one. That's number 6 on the chart. And that was in Woodlands outside of Phoenicia. And then there was Casa Nadal, which was in Shokan and was owned by a person named Bernardo Nadal. Okay, so we might ask, what was the draw to Las Villas? I touched on it a bit already. It was just the scenery, the countryside, the mountains, the beauty, but there was more. And as they developed and grew bigger, they introduced things like music. And after a while, by the 1950s and the 1960s, music by far was the most popular form of entertainment that was offered at the villas. The music at first was very traditional Spanish and Puerto Rican music. The Puerto Rican music in the early, the 40s and the 50s tended to be trios. So trios were just small groups of a couple of guys with guitars, a drummer, and a singer. And they would sing typical ballads of the day. Some would call them jíbaro songs, which is for Puerto Ricans, that's country music. Jíbaros would be those farmers who owned farms up in the hills of Puerto Rico. And of course, there were other Latin sounds that came to be, and those were the larger orchestras, very much like people might be familiar with Tito Puente, who was probably the biggest known band, Latin band, in the country at the time when he came about and became famous. Tito Puente, to most Latin people, is synonymous to, say, Frank Sinatra. I mean, he was that big in the industry. And there were others as well. So the beauty about it is that some of the most famous Latin bands of the day actually played in Las Villas at one time or another in those hotels that could afford to hire them. Some of them were very large, like El Gran Combo, which had 10 to 12 people at any one time, musicians. And they started out in the 60s. And believe it or not, although they may have different players at the time, they still perform to this day, with different musicians. Tito Rodriguez was another huge name in the Latin music industry. He made dozens of albums. His name was very big, both in Puerto Rico, in New York City, and of course, in the Villas. The group on the right is the New Swing Sextet. And so although there were seasoned musicians like Tito Puente and Tito Rodriguez, the New Swing Sextet during the 60s was a very young, up-and-coming band with kind of a new sound. And the young people really kind of looked toward them as, young people like changing up the beat a bit. So we went from traditional trios to the big band of Tito Puente, Tito Rodriguez, and then to a group like the New Swing Sextet that played things like the Boogaloo, which was a new dance craze and sound at the time. So the other draw about the villas was, of course, the food, because people love to have their traditional food. At the villas that catered to more Spanish people and Spanish immigrants, they had their traditional kinds of foods like paella or fabada or other caldo gallego, things like that. And the villas that catered to more of the Puerto Rican clientele, you would have their traditional foods. Like on the right, you have meat pies or pastelillos, as they're called, or empanadas, some people might know them as. And then there was, of course, arroz con pollo. There was morcilla. There was pasteles. There were all these other kind of exotic dishes that only Puerto Ricans and other Latinos would know about. Okay, so I'd like to say a bit about my parents. My parents were, my dad was actually born in Puerto Rico, but at 3 years old, his parents moved to New York City to El Barrio, or Spanish Harlem, as some people know it. My mom was born in Brooklyn. Her parents were from Yauco, Puerto Rico. She was born in Brooklyn, but moved to El Barrio when she was like 7 or 8 years old. And that's where she met my dad. In 1948, with the help of my grandmother, my dad's mom, Irene, they bought a farm. And that was in 1948. And they started it as a farm. And it was primarily a chicken farm with like 300 or 400 chickens. And I guess the idea was to sell eggs. Very soon after that, they found out that farming was not their thing, that the villas were a big thing in Plattekill, and they converted their farm into a resort or villa called Sunny Acres. And that is what I grew up knowing, the villa industry, and specifically that of Sunny Acres. Okay, so this is Sunny Acres, circa 1964. My dad was actually a carpenter and a contractor by trade. So there was one farmhouse on the farm when they bought it. They quickly made that into rooms for guests, but very quickly outgrew it. So my father started constructing buildings. He made a building with rooms. This building here, dining room on the left, it had a dance hall entry. And then to the far right was the bar. I think at their peak, my parents had about 40 rooms that they could rent. And on weekends, they were definitely always booked. Okay, so I'm kind of, I have my thing blocked here. But I think this is the Villa Nueva. I just thought I'd go through some of the villas that existed in the town of Plattekill or in the Catskill region, mostly during the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s. The Villa Nueva was probably the largest of all the villas. They probably had close to 70 rooms, multiple buildings, buildings for dining rooms, dance halls, accommodations. They had a swimming pool, they had a tennis court, and they had a small pond where you could row boats. It was owned by Severino and Amor Garcia, who were Asturian or Spanish immigrants. They had purchased this property in 1931 or so. And although their name was Garcia, they did not name it Villa Garcia because there was already a Villa Garcia in the town. So they named it Villa Nueva. Okay, so here we have another villa in Plattekill. It's called the Villa Galicia. And the Villa Galicia was on the Plattekill-Ardonia Road. And it was started by two Spaniards, Fred and Mary Somoza. and they ran it for a number of years. Eventually, around the end of the 60s, it was purchased by Roberto and Fela Gomez. Roberto being Cuban, Fela being Puerto Rican, and they kept the name Villa Galicia. And of course, they catered to, at by this time, mostly Puerto Ricans. There were still some Spaniards coming up to stay in the very hotel, but the great influx of Puerto Ricans into New York City and the tri-state area, of course, meant that the majority of the tourists that would come up to the villas were Puerto Ricans, with Cubans, Dominicans, and South Americans making up the rest. This, as I mentioned, this is the Villa Garcia. This one appeared a little earlier than the Villa Nueva. Again, this one was from the 20s. It was owned by Celestino and Flora Garcia. Both of them were also Spaniards, so they were Spanish immigrants. Around the late 1970s, the villa was purchased by Clemente and Judy Rodriguez. Clemente and Judy Rodriguez were Puerto Rican. In fact, Clemente and Judy Rodriguez were the ones who purchased my parents' villa, Sunny Acres, in 1971, when my parents sold the villa. They ran that Villa Sunny Acres for about 10 years. And in 1981, they sold that villa to another Puerto Rican couple, and they bought this Villa Garcia and changed the name to Villa Casablanca, or Villa White House. This is the Casa Perez. The Casa Perez was originally owned and started in the late 40s by Daniel Perez and his wife, Dalia Perez. Daniel was Spanish immigrant, Dalia was Puerto Rican. They ran it for quite a few years, probably into the late 70s or 80s. It was then purchased by a Puerto Rican by the name of Andres Figueroa. And Andres changed the name to Villa Campo Alegre from Casa Perez to Villa Campo Alegre. Villa Campo Alegre was probably the last of the villas to exist in Plattekill, and was still in operation into the early part of the 2000s, maybe 2004 or five. But as far as I know, it was the last of the villas to be in operation. This is the Villa Guadarramas. Villa Guadarramas was originally Villa Rodriguez, the first of the villas. And it was bought by Pedro and Gonzalo Guadarramas in the late 50s. They changed the name naturally from Villa Rodriguez to Villa Guadarramas, their last name. And that one also ran for a good 30 years until Pedro Guadarramas became just too elderly. He couldn't find a buyer, and it basically shut down. Okay, there's another one. One of the first, as you enter Plattekill, the south end of Plattekill on Route 32, Villa Victoria. Villa Victoria was originally bought in the 20s by Anna Vega. And Anna was the mother of Joe. Joe took the business over from Anna, and Joe was married. Anna and Joe were Spanish immigrants. Joe married Rita Vega, and Rita was Puerto Rican. So you see, you had a lot of mixes of Spanish and Puerto Rican, because back when you had these communities in New York City, they might have started out as Spanish, but other Spanish immigrant groups came in, and naturally they kind of gravitated to where other people with their similar language and culture would live. So you had this kind of mix. And so it's not unusual to see a Spaniard married to a Puerto Rican and so forth. Okay, this is one of the older villas, one of the originals. again, started in the 20s. This is the Villa Madrid. And the owners were, in fact, from Madrid. This building originally was one of the original settlers of Plattekill, one of the older families, the Giroux families. And this was on the corner of Plattekill Ardonia Road and South Street in Plattekill. The owners were Manuel and Pilar Dafal. This building, they ran it for a good 30, 35 years. And unfortunately, in the late 60s, it caught fire and was destroyed. Okay, so just to talk about some of the hotels that existed in the Kingston area. Again, my own thing is getting, I'm sorry. I think this is the Glenbrook. My name is being covered by some of the other stuff here. But this was owned by Elias Garcia. It's in Shandaken, New York. So it's a big, typical old hotel, probably from the turn of the century or even earlier. You also had La Granja, which again was on the Route 28 corridor, owned by R. Marcos and another person by Fuentes in Alabama, New York. And of course, there was the Roxmore Inn near Woodland or Phoenicia. This is owned by Avelino Garay. And Avelino Garay also owned a hotel, and not a hotel, but a restaurant in New York City. So whether he ran them both at the same time, or if he ran this one seasonally and the other hotel in the off season is, I'm not sure. But this one was located near Phoenicia. So really for the better part of the 20th century, the Villas was by far the most popular destination for Latinos in the entire Northeast. I mean, from what I call the golden era, was between 1950 and 1980, thousands, literally thousands of Spanish and Latinos visited the Villas. And there were probably at any one point in time, 40 or 50 of these resorts and villas in existence. Okay, so I think I already mentioned this. The earliest ones came around about around 1912, lasted well into the 90s. The golden era was again from the 50s to the 80s. And this here shows a sign that existed in the village or the town of Plattekill, showing many of the businesses besides the villas. In fact, some of them were Italian resorts, because there were also a number of Italian resorts that catered to Italian immigrants and people of Italian extraction who came up for more or less the same reasons that, the Jewish Alps, the Jewish Borscht Belt existed and the Villas existed. People wanted to get out into the country. Okay, so the Villas, what happened? The Villas slowly faded. After 1985, they quickly faded after 1985. There were a number in existence by the end of the 20th century, but not many. And they kind of went away for the same reason that the Jewish resorts went away. The younger generation was not looking for the same forms of entertainment, flyaway vacations were much more popular. Other places like Atlantic City, Florida, Miami, things like that were becoming more of a draw. The villas didn't have that glitz, you know, where they were pretty, for the most part, they were basic with fewer amenities. So they just kind of dissipated one by one. Today, if you were to go through Plattekill or even through the Route 28 corridor around Kingston, what you would see are either converted buildings that are being used for other further uses, dilapidated buildings that are not even in use anymore. Some of the buildings were torn down or had burned down. You might see even just empty lots or parcels of land. So I'd like to mention this. A couple of years ago, I think it was in October of 2020, I decided that besides having my book as kind of a memorial to Las Villas and a way of preserving the history, I felt that it needed another type of monument that as people came through town, they would know that this was once an area that had these resorts and that they were very popular for a good amount of time. So through an organization called the William C. Pomeroy Foundation, you can apply to them. And after extensive vetting, and they will check out your sources and your history to make sure that it's legit, they actually approved a sign for Las Villas. And this was the sign that we dedicated in October of 2020. And it sits on the corner of Plattekill Ardonia Road and Huckleberry Turnpike, which if you're familiar with Plattekill, it's kind of the heart of the village near the post office and what used to be the general store. And right behind, you can see Domenico's Pizzeria there. So I was really happy to do this. It was something that I had in mind, but wasn't sure how to go about it. When I discovered this foundation, I quickly had that application put in place. Okay, so aside from that, I decided that being a part of the Plattekill Historical Society, our home office is in the Plattekill Grange on Church Street. And that's where we hold our meetings and a lot of our memorabilia, documents and antiques are stored there. So while Shirley was still alive and the president, she encouraged me to maybe put up a display about the villas. And so I went about getting some memorabilia, some artifacts, some photos, and I set up an exhibit. And this is the exhibit with some of the flags of different groups of people who had visited the villas. As you can see, there were quite a number of different Latin groups. There's some memorabilia. The chair and the sign were from my father's Villa Sunny Acres. There are some pamphlets, news articles, and so forth. Unfortunately, this was during the time of COVID. So not many people have been able to visit. So it kind of is just sitting there at the moment. But hopefully when things come down with COVID, we can have more people come into the offices and you know, maybe see the exhibit. They can appreciate it. So with that, I'd like to end my presentation. Again, I like to take any opportunity I can to preserve the memory of the Villas and to preserve their history so that future generations, especially grandchildren, great-grandchildren of other Latinos will know that this existed and that it was kind of our Camelot. So thank you very much for attending and for allowing me to present this. Jeff, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot, Ish. This was great. So I did have one question about how people got up to that area. I thought I remembered in the 2016 thing, a talk about buses. Did people mostly drive up or did they take buses from Manhattan or someplace in the city?
Yeah, that's a great question because that was a big big part of going to the villas. And very early on, we're talking 1920s and so forth, people took people took boats. There was the day line that came up the Hudson. People took trains. The trains went all the way up to Kingston and then spurs that went out from there to the different resorts, not just the Hispanic resorts and Spanish resorts, but all the resorts. And naturally, people did take cars. And a common route was Route 17. And Route 17 would lead you to Route 32. And Route 32, of course, would take you through Plattekill and up into the Catskills. So that was probably the most common. And of course, you mentioned the buses. And the buses were called JIRAs, J-I-R-A. And JIRAs was just another name for charter buses. And many people would organize these trips. And mostly with the buses, they were day trips, not necessarily overnight. If you were going to stay overnight at a villa or stay through the week for a vacation, you would normally drive up. But the charter buses would be organized by church groups or social groups. And they would bring probably 40 or 50, 60 people on a bus at a time. Some of the villas could actually accommodate like 20 buses. So you can imagine how many people were roaming the grounds of these resorts. They all had to be fed because that was usually part of the ticket. You would get a ride up, you would get a meal, and then you'd get to hear live Latin music. And so, and usually for a meager sum of $4 or $5 a ticket. So it was a great deal. And some of the villas did not like the buses. They tended to think that maybe they didn't bring up the most well-behaved people. So they might not take in JIRAs or buses. They might just take in the drive-in types of tourists. But buses were a big part of the villa scene, and so were cars.
Okay, great. Thanks. So I'm going to turn the Q&A over to Susan Sprackman and take it away. Okay.
We just have a few questions and comments. And actually, one of them is from Peggy Cardillo, who's in the picture wearing like a red shirt. And she'd like you to contact her to talk about presenting at the Empire State Railroad Museum. And I put her question like in a chat to you. Somebody asked if the owners of Via Campo Alegre were any relation to our sheriff, Juan Figueroa.
Yeah, they've been to my presentation, both families, but no, they're not related. I thought they were. I was confused in the beginning too, and thought they were related, but they're not. The sheriff of Juan Figueroa is not related to Andres Figueroa. By the way, Andres Figueroa is one of the two or three surviving owners of the original villas. Mm-hmm. He's something like 96 years old. The other one is, I mentioned her name earlier, Judy Rodriguez, who owned the Villa Casablanca. And they had purchased Sunny Acres from my parents. She still survives. She's in Plattekill, and so's Andres Figueroa. But no, they're not related. But yeah, good question.
Yeah. Any information on Via Vieques?
Oh, yeah, Villa Vieques, yes. So Villa Vieques was one of the villas that existed. I think they started very early in the 1950s, early 50s, and went through the 70s, certainly. The owners were originally from the island of Vieques, which is an island, part of Puerto Rico, off of the coast of Puerto Rico. It's actually in the town of Newburgh. It's not in Plattekill or in Ulster County. It's in Orange County. It was kind of small, but they did bring in buses, so they got pretty good crowds there. Their daughter, Carmen Flores, I know her. I've communicated with her. She provided me photos for my book. The Villa Vieques was around from the time of the golden era, so to speak.
The other comments just talked about how interesting this was, a personal relationship. Rafael's parents spent their honeymoon there, at Casa Perez. My son lives in Highland, and when we drive to his house on 4455, we always pass there's a building that's Vias, and I always wondered, you know, what does that come from? So now I know.
Yeah.
But that was it. I mean, is there any questions that people have that they didn't write in that they'd like to ask right now?
Am I on right here?
Rick? Yeah. Hi, Rick. Yeah, you're on.
How you doing?
Good.
I just wanted to mention a couple of things. When in the early 1930s, you had two bridges built across the Hudson River, the George Washington Bridge, I think around 1932, and about a year before, the Poughkeepsie Bridge. And with the building of those two bridges, there was another bridge earlier in the 20s, 1925, I believe, down in the...
Bear Mountain Bridge.
Yeah, but that was kind of off the beaten path. But when the Poughkeepsie Bridge opened up and the New York Bridge opened to New Jersey, people could get in their car and easily drive up 17 and 32 and get here. I know that was a major reason why Father Divine came to Ulster County in the 1930s, his late 30s, is because he liked to drive his car. He had different cars, but he could get here easily. He could cross the river in two major places and wind up in Poughkeepsie, Plattekill area, New Paltz, and then up Route 28 up into the foothills of the Catskills. Yes,
right.
I just thought I'd mention those two things. I was not aware of the presence of your 1 through 7 or 8 there in up 28. I don't know if any of those buildings are left, but next time I drive up there, I'm going to be looking.
Yeah, I don't know myself if those buildings still exist, but that's a good point you brought up about the bridges. And certainly, you know, I don't know where everybody came from. The Villa service the tri-state area, though, I know that. Many people came from cities in New Jersey, northern New Jersey, Paterson, Newark, Jersey City. And many people came from Bridgeport, Connecticut, as well as the five boroughs in New York City. So, that is a good point you brought up about the transportation. Another big difference was the construction of the New York State Thruway around 1955 or so. And that really made things much easier for people coming up out of the city to get to the vias even faster than they did before.
Yeah, the New York State Thruway around 1950, 51, somewhere through there. That was not going to be built on the west side of the Hudson. It was going to be built on the east side where the earlier Taconic State Turnpike was. But there was a politician from Kingston, New York, who controlled the Senate up in Albany, and he lived in Kingston on the same street I lived in, and he made sure that the thruway crossed the Hudson and came up on the west side, and that brought many people to Ulster County, Orange County, Delaware County, of course. Yeah, I'm trying to think of his name up here. I can't remember his name, but I should. As I get a little older, I get a little rusty. Well, thank you very much. I appreciated your talk. It was wonderful.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. I think that's it.
May I ask a question?
Oh, sure.
Ish, I was wondering if you would speak a bit to Latino and Puerto Rican community that grew up in Plattekill year-round, like in Ellenville, you know, the Borschtfeld brought Jewish families, and then many stayed and put down roots, and Kerhonkson, Ukrainian population. And my husband grew up in Modena, and his father was a member of the Spanish American Democratic Club. And you know, he went to school, obviously, with a lot of, my husband was born in the late 50s. So a lot of his classmates, you know, were Puerto Rican heritage. And I just find it really fascinating that people came, and then, you know, if they were able to, they made it the year round home. And I just think that's, if you could speak a little bit to that, I'd so appreciate it.
Sure. Sure. Well, that's a good point. And my parents were one example of people that moved out of the Bronx, where I was born. Excuse me. They were one example in 1948. They had been coming to the Villas, specifically Villa Rodriguez at the time. And it was because they knew about the Villas because of their community in Spanish Harlem. So naturally, many of the people from Spanish Harlem were visiting those Spanish resorts. And so my parents were one of the earlier Puerto Ricans that came up. And I guess they just decided that they liked the environment. They liked the idea of getting their four children out of New York City. And they liked the idea of running a resort. So they moved up. And I think it happened similarly to other people that maybe even if they didn't start a villa, they came to the area and just fell in love with it. And they said, why not live, you know, here? And I think that's how the community grew. Again, the first ones were Spanish immigrants. And then Puerto Ricans came up to those Spanish resorts, started their own resorts. You know, as I mentioned in my presentation, many of the Spanish resorts were bought by Puerto Rican families. And that's what brought them up. And then it was just kind of one led to the other. And it just became, yeah, it just became a community of you know, with a high Spanish population.
I love it. I think it makes Plattekill so interesting. I think it makes all of Ulster County so interesting when people came and they fell in love with it like so many of us have.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so I want to thank you, Ish, for the wonderful presentation, and also thank you to the people who had a part in the production of this thing, to Susan and to Karen, and this has been great, and also to Libby. I want to thank you for your talk on Shirley, who I knew played a part in your book and everything in your evolution. And I was happy to see Rick Rydant on the screen because he was the person who first introduced me to local history. I was always interested in history, but when I moved here in 71, it was Rick who introduced me to the the canal society, and taught me all about the DNH canal, and I just fell in love with this area in part because of him. So this was a great night. I thank you, and I thank everyone else. We will not be doing another presentation probably until late in the fall, So we're going to take the summer off, and then the Association for Public Historians of New York State is meeting in Kingston for their annual meeting. So we'll be involved in that for a few days. So we look forward to seeing people back, and we'll notify you when something comes up in October or closer to November. And until then, this is a wonderful way to end the spring presentations on the second day of summer. And so thank you, Ish, and thanks to everyone for coming and for the wonderful questions too. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, night.
Yeah.